This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes the three types of cost behavior patterns and why it's important for managers to understand how costs behave with what we call changes in activity. So there are three different types of cost behavior patterns, as you see here: variable costs, fixed costs, and mixed costs. We'll be talking about each of those in the next few slides. And it's very important for managers to understand how costs behave because this enables managers to better predict what will happen to profit in the future based on the level of activity that they expect with, for example, units that will be produced and sold. So we're going to be talking about variable costs, fixed costs, and mixed costs next. Let's start with talking about what a variable cost is. So variable costs vary in total, that's the important part, in total, with changes in volume of activity. So the total cost overall, usually for a period of time, varies depending on the volume of activity. For example, depending on the volume of production, the number of units that we produce. The most common variable costs are direct materials and direct labor. We talk about these specifically in a separate video, so I'll just very quickly define them. Direct materials, those are materials that are easily traced to the product, and direct labor is the labor that is easily traced to the product. And those are the most common, in a production setting, the most common variable costs. So to summarize, total variable costs will change with changes in activity, but the per unit variable cost remains the same. So the term variable relates to total costs, not per unit costs. And the same goes for fixed when we get to fixed, that the term fixed relates to what happens with our total costs with changes in activity, not what happens to the per unit cost. So again, total variable costs will change with changes in activity, for example, with changes in production of our products, and the per unit variable cost will remain the same. So let me give you a quick example here on the next slide. Bikes Unlimited is an example that I use in my textbook, but it can be used generically here as well. This is a company that produces mountain bikes and then sells those mountain bikes to retail stores. And what you're looking at here is an example of variable costs at Bikes Unlimited. The chart that you see up here at the top shows us how much it costs in total to produce three different sets of data, to produce one unit, to produce 2,000 units, and to produce 4,000 units. So this first column right here, second column right here, shows us the total variable costs. And then the next column shows us the per unit variable costs. So remember, the total changes, and that's what we see here, the total changes with changes in activity, and the per unit variable cost does not change with a change in activity. So if we produce one bike, the total, let's go over to the far right. The per unit variable cost will be $60. Look at this. This could be, I don't specify here, but this could be for the direct materials that are used for a particular bike that we are producing. So it's $60 for each unit that we produce for the parts that go into that bike. If we produce one bike, then in total, the cost will be $60. If we produce 2,000 bikes, then the total is going to be $60 per unit times 2,000, or $120,000. And then if we produce 4,000 units, the total variable cost will be 4,000 times $60 per bike, or $240,000. Again, in this example, for direct materials. So if you look at this cost line, this chart right here, this chart shows us what happens with total cost as we increase our production. And those total costs go up, as you see in the chart above, and with this graph below. So this shows us how variable costs will behave with changes in activity, and in this case, activity is defined as units produced. Next, we'll take a look at fixed costs and how fixed costs behave with changes in activity. First of all, the fixed cost does not vary in total. Right? Does not vary in total. It stays the same with changes in volume of activity. It does change on a per unit basis, but it does not, and I'll get to that at the bottom here, but it does not change in total. Examples of fixed costs are salaried personnel, building rent, and insurance. So as a quick example, perhaps we have a production manager that's paid $50,000 a year, just using an arbitrary number, $50,000 a year, regardless of the number of units we produce. We're using the example of mountain bikes here in this video. So if we produce one mountain bike or 100 mountain bikes, that salary stays the same and is set at $50,000. That's a fixed cost. So to summarize, total fixed costs, total, do not change. So when we use the term fixed, we're talking about total costs. However, the per unit fixed cost does change with changes in activity. For example, if we produce one bike, the cost of that production manager is $50,000. If we produce two bikes, the cost is cut in half to $25,000 per unit. So the per unit cost does change with a fixed cost, but the total does not. Here's an example of a fixed cost at Bikes Unlimited, using our Bikes Unlimited example. If you look at the chart here, let's say that this $20,000 is for our lease of the production facility on a monthly basis. So the total cost here of $20,000 will stay the same regardless of the number of units that we produce. So if we produce one unit, we still pay a total of $20,000. If we produce 2,000 units, we still pay $20,000. If we produce 4,000 units, we still pay for the factory lease $20,000. However, you'll notice here that our per unit fixed cost changes. If we produce one unit, it's $20,000 per unit, 20,000 divided by one. If we produce 2,000 units, it's $10 per unit, or $20,000 total cost divided by 2,000. And as you see, as production goes up, the cost per unit goes down. And the chart that you see at the bottom here reflects what's happening with total fixed costs given changes in production. And the answer to that is nothing's happening because it stays fixed at $20,000. So this is an example of a fixed cost. Remember, the term fixed applies to what happens to total costs with changes in activity. And the answer to that is they stay the same. Next, we'll take a look at mixed costs. So what is a mixed cost? It actually has a combination of fixed and variable costs within it. And an example of a mixed cost is if we pay our salespeople a monthly salary, which is a fixed component. No matter how many they sell, they get a monthly salary. And we also add to that a commission, in this example, based on the number of units that are sold. So this is that would be a variable cost. So this is an example of a mixed cost. It has both components, a fixed and variable cost. Mixed costs, what are the characteristics here of mixed costs? They change with changes in activity, and they change in total, and they also change on a per unit basis. So again, mixed costs, if we have changes in activity, the total will change, and the per unit cost will change. So that's how the costs behave when we're looking at a mixed cost. Here's an example of a mixed cost, again, using our Bikes Unlimited example. Let's assume that this relates to our sales personnel. Let's say it's one person. That one person is paid $10,000. Let's say this is on a monthly basis. Again, we're kind of just making up numbers here, but is paid $10,000 a month regardless of the number of units sold. And then for each unit sold, that person is paid $7. So if the salesperson sells one item, one bike, then in a given month, that salesperson is going to be paid $10,007. That is the $10,000 salary plus the $7 per unit. I'll do one more of these. If that same salesperson sells 2,000 units in 1 month, then we're going to pay that person $24,000, which is the $10,000 fixed amount, plus the 2,000 units times the $7 per unit. And then that's reflected on this graph as well. And what you see here, the y-intercept shows us the fixed cost, because if that salesperson doesn't sell anything, that is, no units are sold, we're right here at zero, we still pay $10,000. Our cost as a company is still $10,000. And of course, that goes up as our salesperson increases sales. So if our salesperson sells 2,000 units, as you see up above up here, then that salesperson gets paid $24,000. So this is an example of a mixed cost. What is the equation that we use to describe a mixed cost? This is stated using different variables in different textbooks and in different settings, but these are the variables that I use in my textbook, but we can use them generically here as well. What we're looking at is identifying how a total mixed cost is calculated. Remember, it has a fixed cost component, so we will start with total fixed cost, and it has a variable cost component. To find the total mixed cost, we take the total fixed cost plus the unit variable cost times the number of units. And here is the equation y equals f plus vx, describing that. And y is our total mixed cost, f is the total fixed cost, v is the variable cost per unit, and x is the level of activity. So the total mixed cost, y, equals the total fixed cost, f, plus variable cost per unit, times the number of units, if we want to use units as our level of activity. I'll be using this equation when in separate videos, about four separate videos, when I describe how to break out fixed and variable costs into the separate components using the account analysis method, high-low method, scatter graph method, and regression analysis. But those will be separate videos. I will be using, though, this equation when we get into those discussions. The term relevant range is an important one when we're talking about trying to estimate costs. So what does it mean? What does the relevant range term actually tell us? The relevant range, it's the range of activity for which our cost behavior patterns are likely to be accurate. And we're really talking about fixed cost and variable cost. Within what range of activity can we make the assumption that those cost estimates are accurate? For example, with the Bikes Unlimited company that we were talking about earlier, it may be that our production capacity is anything up to, let's say, 6,000 units, and anything beyond that, we have to actually get into a new factory or hire additional employees or pay overtime, and we suddenly are out of the relevant range when it comes to estimating costs. So it's the range of activity for which we can assume our total fixed cost will stay the same and our per unit variable cost will also be accurate. So if we go outside of the relevant range, then we have to reevaluate and recalculate our estimated costs. The last thing I'd like to talk about with this video is how cost behavior patterns are used by managers. We go through all this work to identify how costs behave. It's important to know why that is done. The best way to accurately predict costs is really to understand whether costs are fixed or whether they are variable. And once we have that information, it allows managers to answer questions like, if my unit sales go up 5%, how will that affect my costs? Or something like, what if I add a product line? How will that affect the costs at our company? Or what happens if we increase automation in the production process, which typically increases our fixed costs? But those are the types of questions that are going to be answered by identifying cost behavior patterns.